Good evening. It is 6:35 on the 3rd of August, and this is a convener's meeting of the Warrant and Finance Committee for fiscal year 2016. I am acting in the capacity of convener at the moment, being the surviving chair of the 2015 Warrant and Finance Committee. It is noted that there are four of us here, so we apparently do have a quorum. And that having been said, our first order of business will be to establish the officers for the fiscal year 2016 Warrant and Finance Committee. I have made it clear, I think, to most people that I'm not particularly interested in doing this job again.
Yeah, that's quite.
Well, I think I never wanted to be chair to start with, and secondly of all, I think the town is in order of some changes taking place here, some significant changes taking place, and at the age of 71, I would prefer not to be shaping those. I can offer advice from what has worked in the past, having been part of this municipality and the municipal government for over 40 years now, but I think it's time for younger people to undertake the effort of deciding how the move forward should go. And I also should be noted that obviously I've had some conflicts with the powers that be.
I understand what you're saying, but I personally think that having a chairperson who has had the experience of being in the town government, even if it's on a peripheral committees, is important. You know what it has been, you know what it should be in your own mind, you know the power brokers, you know the people whom we have to contact in order to get a clearer picture on various warrants that come before the committee. Personally, I think your having been here for so long is an advantage and not a disadvantage, but that's just my own personal opinion.
Well, thank you, Bill, for that compliment. However, I'm perfectly willing to offer retrospective, but I would like to see younger people shape the move forward, okay? And maybe I'm a little too much attached to the past. Having said that, I would also look around and note there are two other people here who have played an influential role in municipal government lately, right?
I'll play the old age card and nominate.
No.
The wise part.
The wise part.
Okay.
Having been part of the government and willing to step back.
Okay. What we need first off is a nomination for the position of vice chair, as that's called for in the ordinance, and also I've combined that for purposes of organization with also secretary. So I think, and then that person should run the election for chair. So I, as convener, will accept nominations for the position of vice chair, and that can be somebody who's not here, too. And
let me ask another question, if I might.
Yes, go ahead.
Is it possible that we have a temporary chair this evening, since we do have a quorum, but yet we don't have a full committee, and discuss who will be the permanent chair at our next and subsequent meeting? To have only the four of us make a decision, especially if it's going to involve people who aren't here, is not very good, because they can easily say, I'm sorry, but I'm not in a position to do this. And
I think it's a wise suggestion.
I think that's very good. That sounds very good.
So I would like Mr. Temporary Chairman to make a motion that we continue with you as Temporary Chairman throughout this meeting, with the subsequent election for a permanent chair and vice chair to be determined at the next scheduled meeting.
If that's a motion, I would second it.
Yes, ma'am, it's a motion.
Are you comfortable with
that?
Sure. Well, I can't. I just walk out the door and go home. Excuse me.
Come on.
Excuse me. Okay. That having been decided, I guess I will be in the position of temporary chair for this evening, and we will postpone the election of officers until we have a full board here. Does that work for everybody?
Elise and Tom do arrive this evening.
We could do it.
Okay.
Very good. Okay. You all know that I took the well, I suggested to the chairman, or to the chairman of Warrant and Finance 2 weeks ago, that we probably could act on this warrant without great difficulty tonight. I took a liberty in doing that.
Is this the one Ms. Rue sent to all of us?
Yes, this is the draft, July 24 draft of the warrant for the...
Well, the copy that it wouldn't copy.
August 20 meeting.
Would you and Nancy be willing to share so that William and I could share?
I tried to get a copy of that off my printer, but it wouldn't print.
It wouldn't print.
It was the draft.
There you go.
Thank you.
2015.
Can we share here?
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
We play bridge on weekends.
Excuse me. Superintendent has noted that he has a 2.5-hour drive this evening, and I did ask Ken to come first and the school committee to come second, I think, but if it's okay with Ken, can we move ahead with the school committee articles?
I'm at 7 o'clock, so I'm...
Very good. All right. Thank you. Having said that, the first article having to do with the school is, and it is Article 2, to see if the town of Acton will authorize the appropriation of an additional $60,800 from the school's undesignated fund to offset taxes. That's Article 2.
I don't think there's an awful lot of discussion about
no.
that.
No, none whatsoever.
Make a motion that we fully recommend passing of the article.
And I second that motion.
Okay. Its motion has been made and seconded to accept it. Is there any discussion? Would the superintendent or the chair care to fill us in on what's transpired to get us to this position so that the public has an idea of what's actually happened?
Yeah, I don't mind. As you know, during the budget thing, we added a pre-K program to the
right.
Acton has been experiencing declining enrollment over the last 5 years, particularly close to 100 students have come off the rolls, so
yep.
at the K-8 level.
Excuse me, Bob, just a minute. Are you picking that up, Virginia? You are, okay.
At the K-8 level. By offering a pre-K program next year, we didn't anticipate the number of students that, during the budgeting process, that actually showed up or going to show up. We had budgeted for a 16-student program, and we had interest of close to 27 or 28, all Acton students, which is an interesting thing, and we've got 23 commitments for full-day program for 5 days a week. The school committee and the pre-K committee looked at different combinations of programs, and that the full-day program is the one that they wish to support. As a result of that, state law has a 8-to-1 student ratio, adult to students, students to adults, and for every 16, you need one full teacher. You can have an ed tech, so one teacher for 8, ed tech for 8, a total of 16. Problem is 23 takes us over the 16 limit. Past school practice has been, this I was informed by committee members, that in kindergarten, when the town has exceeded 16 students, they've added an additional teacher.
When we exceeded 20.
Yeah. Okay. And I have not found that actually in policy, so we need to address that permanently in the policy. So based on that past practice for kindergarten, now that we had a pre-K, they felt that even though it's not required by the school, by the state, to offer pre-K, but the school committee has wanted pre-K, we need to add an additional position to cover this additional enrollment. And we can do that by shifting that out of the undesignated fund. And stay within the undesignated fund policy still and not have to change the budget. And just as a reminder, awareness, when the budget, during the budgeting process and town election and so forth, we asked for a reserve accounts that set aside. And if those happened, we would decrease our fiscal year budget next year by $110,000, which we have in the process of returning. In addition, at the end of the fiscal year of the calendar year 15, we're returning an initial $60,800. So in total, I think we said what we do and we've done what we said we do.
Okay, so $60,800 listed in the article, it was that final transfer that we understood was to take place during the budgeting process.
And the reason that you wanted, Ted, when you came, is your tax credits go or something August 11th, and so you need to have final finality.
Right, we understand that.
That was actually in addition to the $110 million.
Right.
Budget.
Right.
I have a question. So, fully applaud smaller class sizes, that is especially for those younger ages. So if there are 23 Acton residents that are enrolled into, I'm assuming then, two pre-K classes, is this an opportunity, because the news is full lately of the decrease in pre-K programs privately, could we tap into pre-K students and Newfield students, pre-K students in Shapley and Newfield, whose parents would be interested in tuitioning their children in to our pre-K program to bring those classes up to 16 kids per class?
That was brought to the school committee's attention, and I'll let them answer how they decide.
I don't remember that we ever made any real decision on that. It was something that was discussed at one point.
If we did that, we'd have to also add another ed tech to make this work.
Oh, so you're going to be sharing an ed tech between the two full classes?
Yes. So we could handle with three people, we have two teachers in ed tech, we handle 24 students. We can't handle...
Right now we have 23.
To be fair to any saint that takes the pre-K job, they might wish to have an ed tech full-time in their classroom anyway.
That's right. They only have eight?
No, if they had...
If they have seven? Because right now we have 23.
Right, so I'm saying that
so
if you...
So we have one of 16, if we divide them up that way. We have one of 16, or we could divide them in two and have 11.
12. Well, and that, I think that was my suggestion, is that if you had two equally sized classes, that would, even if you only went up to 16 students per class, and you really, in theory, could go to 18, but I think for pre-K, 16's better.
It's a lot.
That would, oh, okay. That would then give you seven tuitioned in students that would be maybe interested in coming. And since pre-K, for instance, at the YMCA is $250 a week, it might be something that would generate enough income to offset the cost of another ed tech, as well as generate income for the school.
Well, we're just beginning this project, you know, when you have personal, but look into something. Plus, you know, to get these people to apply, and we wanted to make just one pre-K, that brought all a whole issue of trying to filter these kids out and whatnot, and that brought on, we can't really eliminate anybody that wants to come.
Totally.
And that's why we're here. So introduce all of this to another two towns, would probably be overwhelming at this time. I mean,
it's something that the board could bring up at a meeting and discuss, certainly, and see if that's something that everybody would like to pursue. We only have the next number of slots.
Yep, thank you.
You know, that's, I don't think it's an impossibility. I think it's just something that we've been trying to get off the ground with everything else.
Yes.
So to take care of all of our own, so we haven't gotten there.
One thing, it's very difficult for schools to predict what their enrollment is going to be even for kindergarten up until really late in the school year. In fact, back when we were doing this, we anticipated kindergarten next year to have only eight kids in it. And as the year has ended, we now have 12. So any one year, it could go. And so I think it's
proven. And we know we're going to need two kindergarten teachers next year, because
so
we're definitely going to be over the 20, because there are still kids in Acton that are going to preschool someplace else, because they already had made a commitment and they wanted to follow through that commitment. So next year, for sure, we're going to need two kindergarten. So if we have less than 16 preschoolers next year, then we can just move a teacher up to kindergarten, preschool to kindergarten. I think they were hired with that in mind.
And I happen to know Shannon is at pre-K also this year.
Oh, okay.
They are they're actually further behind in the process than we are, but they have a wait list of five as of yet this morning. I was over there this morning. And we have no wait list. We had, as you say, 27 or 28 interested, but 23 committed.
Do we know whether or not they're going to take care of these five, or could it be something like we do with our high school students with Sanford and ask them to come and pay for the five to come to our?
It's a possibility.
Yeah,
it's something we can take up in a board meeting. I think that could be very well put on an agenda.
How soon into the school year will you be able to say this figure is pretty much rigid now? We pretty much
know. Second week of September.
So by the second week of September.
I would say from past experience of enrollment changes,
changed.
Just some people just don't show. And Kenneth, I think we're really good on the pre-K, but on other grade levels.
And with pre-K, you're...
Just to let you know, over 10% of the school population will be in pre-K.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
But that's the future of where it's going.
Well, and actually, though, that's actually not that out of line, because we have 10 grades.
That's correct.
So it should be about 10%.
But it's, but the point is, it's leveling off. It's not continuing the decline. It's, I think...
I hope.
Yeah, that's what you're suggesting anyway, with that number.
That's what we hope.
Yeah.
And the reason is, during the pre-K process, they did a lot of grilling of, like, okay, how many three-year-olds you got? How many two-year-olds you got? So I think we have better data than we've ever had in terms of...
And what does it, does it suggest to you a leveling off?
More
does. Okay. All right.
And did we have any children who are now in the program or scheduled to be in the program who perhaps don't meet the criteria in terms of social development, et cetera, under normal circumstances? Everyone who has applied gets in. Is that the way it works with pre-kindergarten?
4 years old.
Okay. Mm-hmm. There's the age.
And one of the beauties of this program is that they can, child development services has been a part of getting it started, and any services that these kids need will be paid for through that, because they're not five yet, they're still four, so child development will pay for things like hearing
and
any extra things that they need. So that's a real,
real plus.
Plus, if they get that before they actually start kindergarten, which would then the parents would have to pick it up.
Will the children be on the buses for the regular students?
This first year, it was required, they have to transport themselves.
They transport themselves?
The rules say you don't have to offer it.
Right.
And I'll just put you on, in RSU 57's case, they, because they did, they're on their bus fleet, they're configuring some buses to arrange for the seating. We have a contract with First Student, and also we talked to Ledge Mayor, which is another one, and that they're going through the process, because this pre-K thing is happening nationwide, and they're all gearing up. So our bus contract comes up this year for negotiation, and that will be a requirement that they have the right
equipment to service that population. That's a marginal population, I gather, in terms of behavior on a bus,
well,
right?
I think the real, from the state point of view, it's making sure the kid is strapped in. Cause
yes, yeah. Yeah.
Specific seats compared to
everything. They're like 30 pounds. They're just going to be bouncing up and down.
Okay. Is there additional discussion on this article?
The only other question I have is that the first part was talking about giving money back to the town. This was a part of the original plan during the process of budgeting for 2016. Can you just elaborate on that real quickly so that people will ask that at the meeting?
In our original budget, which had to be done fairly early in the year, we saw that we were able, with all of the contingency funds passed, that would allow us to give $110 back to the town for $110,000 back to the town for
that already happened.
Okay. So we did that. We voted that, and that went through on our school budget at the town meeting. However, we found out after that, by the end of the school year, but when the fiscal year was closing, we were able to come up with another $61,000-something to add to that to give back to the town. We had a certain amount of money, and the board, we had some needs at the school. The board decided to take part of that and split it and give part of that back to the town for tax relief, and to use the other part for the needs that we had. So.
That came up as we were finishing up Warrant and Finance meetings with the school budget.
So the school actually gave back to the town $171,000 for tax purposes this year.
Any additional questions?
No, but those are very important issues that may very well come up by the voters or at the meeting. As to how is it that this money is coming back to the town, and then number two is the fact that the monies that are being asked for the additional personnel are in fact ones that are already budgeted because of the taking it out of a fund that was specifically designated for data that we had no finger on, is that correct?
That's correct. We could have said, and this was discussed at the meeting too, well, we haven't really, that extra $60,000 hasn't really gone to the town meeting yet, so if we want, we can pull that back and use that for the teacher, but the board felt we've made that commitment to the town, we wanted to follow through with that, and we have enough money in our undesignated account to pull that money out for the cleanup.
And the reason is, the budget vote was voted at a certain level, and we're actually going above it by the $60,000.
Correct.
That's the real problem.
Yes, yeah.
Tom had said, other than the school needs, you should come back, make sure you ask for it so you have the authority to.
Okay, there's a motion to, I believe, accept the article as read for all intents and purposes, or recommend the article as written?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, is that what we understand it to be?
Yes.
Okay, so.
Second the motion.
All in favor?
Am I voting?
Opposed? Yes, you may vote. Okay. Okay.
Yeah, go ahead and make a motion on Article 3, as we've already discussed it as part of Article 2.
I know we have, I don't want to read it first for the, for the.
That's good of you, that's very good of you.
Okay, thank you. Larissa, are you anxious to get home?
No, I just like efficiency.
Bob, you think you're all done, huh? You're sure? No, that's all right, if you need, go ahead, thank you. I think we have covered it. However, Article 3 of this warrant is to see if the town will authorize a transfer of and appropriate $60,000 from the school undesignated fund to fund Article 2, regular instruction to cover the expenses of an additional pre-K teaching position. To fund Article 2. Excuse me, let me read this again. To see if the town of Acton, authorize the transfer of and appropriate $60,000 from school undesignated fund to fund Article 2, regular instruction to cover the expense of an additional pre-K teaching position. Does anybody know what that article says?
Yes. I think that it's just missing a little bit of punctuation.
I think we're missing something.
So regular instruction is on the school, if I'm correct. Article 2, and this is Roman numeral 2 as opposed to Article 2 in this style of 2. So in the school budget that we voted on this past spring, Article 2 is for regular instruction, and that this is going to appropriate $60,000 to regular instruction.
That's right.
So we're just missing a comma after regular instruction.
Okay.
So I think that that's all that's happened there.
Is that consistent with your understanding and?
So we just talked about, I thought that was.
Okay.
Yes, you jumped the gun a little bit, but it's clear.
That's all right.
Okay. Are we all clear on what this is all about now?
Yes.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
I need to clean my glasses the next time I read one of these drafts. Catch that ahead of time. All right. Is there a motion on this article?
I make a motion as.
To accept the article as written?
Yes.
Recommend the article as written? Second?
Yeah.
Seconded? Discussion?
Already happened.
Yep.
We have already discussed, is that what we understand?
Excellent. Everybody wins.
All in favor? Those opposed? Good evening, Mr. England, Dr. England.
Thank you, sir.
And school committee members, if you would like to, you can hang around if you would like, but I think we've covered this from your point of view. Jeanette, Judy?
It's all been approved.
Fran, are you still here?
Thank you very much for.
You can, you're welcome to stay if you wish. Yes, I agree, 100%.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Good night.
Okay, moving on to Article 4, to see if the town of Acton. Will authorize the transfer of and appropriate $3,400.
And appropriation of.
And appropriation of, yes, I think this was.
We're not a driver-checking committee, though, it's okay.
No, but I, you know.
We'll transfer, or we'll transfer and appropriate.
So instead of adopted as written, we'll adopt it as corrected.
Adopted as corrected.
It's grammatically correct.
Let's get this right, okay? Just so we're correct here. To see if the town of Acton will authorize the transfer of and appropriation of.
If you.
Transfer and appropriation of, the of goes over here. Okay? $3,419 from the town undesignated fund to cover unanticipated wages slash taxes of the code enforcement department. Okay. To cover unanticipated wages, taxes of the code. Is that what we all agree this says?
Yes.
It's supposed to say? All right. Let me read that again so we can get the wording clear to the clerk. To see if the town of Acton will authorize the transfer and appropriation of, the of is added, the will is added, $3,419 from the town undesignated fund to cover unanticipated wages slash taxes of the code enforcement department. Okay. Is there a motion?
I move we accept the article as read.
As read, okay, with the insertion.
Oh, yes.
Yes, as read, okay.
Yep.
I will second that.
Okay. Discussion. Now, Ken, I know that you have had some discussion with the selectmen concerning a change in your job description and a proposed pay increase, and your hours are increasing. Those are all the things I understand from the rumor, but I would like to hear from you, and I'd like to hear, I guess, from Selectman Walsh with respect to this article. So what is happening here?
What was the total number you had?
3419.
I had 3319. So, and that could be just something a bookkeeper brought up, that there was an error and added for taxes or something like that.
This is
what we've tried to do over the last couple of years is filling a hole and trying to address some issues we have at the code enforcement office and planning board. I've tried to keep it as a part-time office since I've been here, and the increased load just keeps coming and coming. The thing that always sits on the side is enforcement. We prioritize inspections, permits, and have safety complaints right off the bat, but there's always a ton of enforcement issues to be done. So a couple of years ago, through the budgeting process, we expanded the deputy line to pick up another gentleman to work 10 hours a week. And he lasted 4 or 5 months or so, and now he's fully certified. He's working for the town of Kennebunk. Originally,
Paul Demers. Got to work for Paul.
Yeah. Originally, when I proposed this, the selectmen wanted to just increase my line and have me take it over. I was trying to pull in a second person, so I wouldn't have the commitment of the full-time job, and was able to do other projects too to offset my salary. But reality, looking back, it's going to be very difficult to find a part-time person, get them certified, and keep them for very few hours. Similar problem that the town guard has. As soon as she certifies somebody, they go to the other side of 95 and work with great benefits and great jobs and move right up the ladder. We're looking at somebody going up the ladder or coming down the ladder to keep that individual. Currently, for June, my numbers in June, we've got 222 building permits that are open and active. Mm-hmm. That doesn't include electrical, mechanical, plumbing, septic, shoreland, stormwater, any of that. We have 102 shoreland zoning permits, and the majority of that is tree removal permits. 10 years ago, we were happy if somebody just told us they were cutting trees, but we weren't getting any replanting. So now with the permitting process, and we've changed the fee schedules to cover all this additional work. And now we're actually going out and enforcing that the replanting be done. We've got 27 open violations, and last month was 125 inspections, 3 training events, and every Saturday we were working on that one. July's numbers are about the same. They've increased a couple of more because we're not closing them out. We just keep adding and adding to them.
You mean mean, you're adding at a faster rate than you're closing out at this point in time. Yeah, with summer here, yeah. Yeah, and the pickup in the economy, too.
Mr. Paul, may I ask you a question, sir?
Sure.
How arduous is the certification process that you require your people to get?
It's a state requirement, and it used to be 6 or 7 areas of certification. It's now 13, and it's multi-part exams for each of them. And then the other aspect of it is now we also have a continuing education to maintain those, too.
So Ken, this money is to, the $3,300 is simply to increase your salary for an additional few hours a week? That seems like a very low amount of money.
We took the deputy's line, which was $13,000, and we grabbed, I think it was $3,000 from planning also. So the job description that the selectmen approved last week at their meeting turns it into code enforcement and goes more planning in code enforcement. So we're working with the planning board. We're going to take the applications in. We're going to review them. We're going to help with drafting ordinances, working with ordinances, coordinate ZBA meetings, and not only attend the meetings, but also give input and advice to them, which is basically what we've been doing, but it's never been a job description. I do have copies of the job description if you guys are giving it.
We have not seen anything. So if you have an extra copy,
does this mean that you do actively participate in the planning committee at each meeting or only when you're called upon?
No, I attend all the meetings, go to sidewalks, public hearings, all that.
Okay.
And he has for years, even as his part-time capacity.
Well, to the extent that he's been able to, and that's been an issue.
So Ken, you're now considered full-time 40 hours a week?
I don't think they call full-time 20s.
I understand that, but we do have Jennifer is also a 40-hour-a-week expected. So is that yours as well?
This would bump up to 35.
Okay. And whereas before you were at 30?
20.
Yeah. But when I was hired 18, 19 years ago, it was what Mr. Neal said, it said, I think it was 10 hours a week, but it was you take care of what comes through the door. And that's something we've always done, is if I come in on today was a 12-hour day on Monday, by the time I get to Friday, my hours are up on Thursday, basically. But if somebody's looking for inspections, that keeps their business going, keeps money flowing for them, or we need to approve things, we take care of them as we need to. So that's a comparison to where we were a couple of years ago compared to where we are now with permit numbers. This is the updated job description. Everything underlined on the job description was added.
And Ken, did you help write the job description?
We stole it from the town boss.
Okay. So you approve of the job description, I guess, is the question I'm asking.
Correct, yeah.
Is the job description reasonable? Well, I mean, looking at it, can this person, such as yourself or others, perform this for the amounts of money that we're talking about if they came in brand new? Or is this something that would look nice on paper but would require 3 or 4 people to perform
I think if I was to leave, you would may have difficulty finding somebody right off the board to replace this. As we see in the other communities, when they put the health warning sign up because the code officer left and it went from one town to another, and all the towns just shift when that happens, they have a huge criteria for it, but when they get the applications, none of the criteria is met. Because they're looking for a certified individual.
Sure.
You've got 1 year to be certified in 13 areas of exams that the state gives you exams 4 times a year, so you'd have to take 3 to 4 exams each time you go up. So when you're studying for those exams, you're not probably not going to pass any if you're going in to take 3 or 4 exams versus focusing on 1 or 2. So the realistic of finding certified individuals is a lot harder than it was.
Chairman?
It's become a much more professional position than it was 10 years ago or 20 years ago. Excuse me, Mr. Cashin. Yes.
As a planning board member of longstanding, who has worked by Ken's side in drafting a lot of our shoreline zoning revisions over the past decade or so. I would just like to speak to his competency and willingness to roll his sleeves up and get involved in the town's work, involved in the, which is expanding yearly, involved in the code enforcement officer position. He's done an outstanding job.
Thank you, Tom, and I'd like to second that. I have business very frequently with a lot of people who do a lot of work in town that Ken administers for the town, and mostly I hear good. Sometimes I hear complaints. Well, the complaints I hear generally result from, I think, you being overloaded, frankly. It's inability to show up for inspection when somebody wants, or inability to respond at short notice, and I understand that, seeing sort of both sides. So, and I think that for the most part, what I hear from builders and others out there in the profession, we probably have one of the best code enforcement officers anywhere around.
Tough but fair.
Right, tough but fair. But, you know, good, as I have said many times, bad code enforcement is worse than none at all, because all it does is create confusion and cost money.
It's like a bad ordinance.
Like a bad ordinance, right, right. Right, exactly.
I have another question, sir. If the amount of responsibilities are going up, it looks like almost incrementally, in another 2 years or so, do you foresee having to come back for additional personnel? Be very frank about it, because I don't see how you could do it, this job description as it states now.
Organization is key to a lot of it, and it's very difficult when somebody on, and Acton's a huge town, when somebody on the north side of town wants an inspection, and you were just there 10 minutes ago, 15 minutes ago, and they expect you to come right back out. So organization of it is key for your timing of everything, and being organized helps on a lot of it. Unknowing what the additional regulations may come at the state level, I think we can assume probably not much land use wise. Lovely, who knows what it would come out of it, but I don't see additional staffing needed to handle what we've got. My secretary right now handles a tremendous amount of the workload right now. She's got it well criteria, so as the stuff goes through, it flows really good, and she has everything ready for me and permitted for me, and all I have to do is, after I review it, is sign it. With the checklist we have when we go through a project, we can checklist it, I give it to her, and she has the permit ready. The other issue is usually violations. If I see a violation, check guilty or something like that, brand new, no paint on it, sticks out like a sore thumb. Take a picture of it, email it back to my office, everything from my computer goes to hers, and all I have to do is write 123 Main Street. When I get back to my office, the notice of violation letter is already written. If she has the time, she's pulled it up, she's researched who it was, where it was, if we've had permits, and she's already got the letter written.
Go Brenda.
She is awesome in that aspect. She's streamlined a lot of stuff, so if I was to lose her, yeah, I would need that.
I think, though, that, Ken, that's a good thing for people to hear, that we, like, as a town, that we actually, we are a very small town, we have very few staff members in the town hall, but we are very fortunate right now to have a crackerjack staff that is efficient and knowledgeable and experienced, and, yeah.
Just so we can clarify this for the public now, you are right now working how many hours a week, presumably, before?
Selected, I've moved me to the 35.
Okay, but what were you before this?
Officially.
Officially, 24, 25.
So 24, 25 hours, and that schedule goes back at least 10 years.
Easily, yeah.
Yeah, it goes back to, shortly after you came on board, actually, I think, 1 or 2 years, yeah. So, and you're going now to 35 hours a week officially?
Correct.
Okay, so how much are you making now total and, or how much will you be making?
Hourly's $33.18, I think.
$33.18 an hour?
You're still paid hourly as opposed to being paid a yearly salary?
Well, that's how it's broken down.
No, it's a salary, it has been a salary, it's a salary, right? Okay, $33.16 does not sound absorbent to me at all for...
For a professional.
For the work it's being...
No way.
And it is...
That's going to be your new salary.
That's the current, we'll just add more hours to it, so it's not a...
Oh, I see, I see. It's not a raise, it's just more hours.
Trying to catch up a little bit.
Ken, what is that per year?
Around $60,000.
Okay. Compared to the other communities, that is very...
Acton's really unique to compare to another community. We've got 125 miles of shoreline zoning, 25 of it's navigational. That's a lot of shoreline zoning. We've got no commercial, we've got a population of 3,000 to 4,000, but yet the tourism comes back up. So we're trying to compare with Rangeley and a few other towns. Rangeley was where I had actually stole a lot of the job description from, but somebody left, new person came on, and he has no planning capability and can't do any of that. So they've gone just back to a CEO, LPI, and whatever they can do for planning.
Well, I spend quite a bit of time on the municipal job boards, and $60,000 a year for a experienced CEO is, we're getting a good deal. So...
That's my belief also. Okay.
I'd like to ask one other question, and that is, there was a, before the budget was approved, there was discussion about someone having a boat available in order to help his job in inspecting along the shore, and I was just wondering what the status of that is, Mr. Chairman, do you know?
It's been approved.
It's been approved.
I'm waiting for after Labor Day. I think we'll get much more for our money and hopefully not have to spend it. Ideally, is if we find a good boat. The ones I found are all on the seacoast, and I'm not sure how the saltwater affects these. Looking for like a semi-console Boston Whaler type with a four-stroke engine, hasn't been in the saltwater. And ideally, if you find the right thing, you're going to get the life jackets, the whistle, the fire extinguisher, the oars. If you have to buy that additionally, you can add another $1,000 with all the stuff.
Surely.
So we're just watching for after Labor Day. I think we'll get a lot more of our money and hopefully have a surplus left over of it too.
And I assume that will also add to your already efficient operation.
We've had a spike in the shoreline zoning. Just the word of it and the talk of it has already spiked the permitting, which was one aspect we were looking for. And I think it will take a couple of years for the ask for forgiveness versus permission aspect of it. But we're already seeing quite a bit of it.
Good. Okay. I've got one to report to you too, a dock falling in. But we'll get to that later. Okay, additional questions? Any additional questions, comments from the public? Anybody have anything to offer? Mr. Neal, thoughts?
The only thing I have to offer a boat out there here, I thought it looked like a very nice boat that I think would fit the other mill down in Sanford on River Street. Really on the intersection, right across from where the high school street is.
Yeah.
The console has a little top on it. I think I saw that one.
Yeah, thunderstorms.
No, there was one on Craigslist in Sanford, and he couldn't get it to sign. So. But that's my biggest fear, buying something that needs maintenance.
Right. Yeah. Mr. Walsh, anything?
No.
Anything to add?
Pretty much, you've covered everything that's from the selectmen's office side. I'm glad you did clarify there was no raise in hourly rate. All we simply did was raise his time, his commitment time.
Right.
From the $25 to $35.
And I don't...
And that's an important issue, very much so,
yes.
Especially at the meeting.
Yes. I was going to ask, when every year most of the employees always get a incremental rate, we get a raise, whether it's 1.5% or 3%, usually based on the COLA. I believe, Ken, that's all you've gotten, correct? Is that pretty much all you've gotten over the years?
There was a time when the economy was bad. We understood that we didn't even get that.
Okay.
And generally, that's been it. There could have been a spike here and there 10, 15 years ago, but that's been generally
it. Okay, you've been pretty much playing, been same with a minimal raise throughout the
And a lot of it is my fault to try to keep it into a part-time. When I look at the neighboring communities working 35, 40 hours, we were trying to keep it as reasonable as practical, because it is a small town. But when you look at the shoreline zone we have in town, which is our main tax basis, that's, we want to keep the lakes high quality, so that's what we like to move into.
We also did a, went online to MMA, did a survey of all the enforcement officers throughout the state. It was a little hard to come up with apples and apples. Some of them were code enforcement officers. Some of them also had other things that you had to add into it, different panels. His rate is comparable.
Yeah, yeah.
What his job is. He has a large, a very large job to do.
Yep.
We basically wanted to bring it up and make sure he's compensated for the time that he's putting in. And this goes, he goes back several months that he had been putting in all these extra hours. So, that's why we raised his hour.
Okay, thank you. I think from what Mr. Cashin said, that he is probably going to vote in the affirmative, but we can move ahead without him if...
I think we should move ahead.
You think we should move ahead?
Yes.
Okay. I understand. Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead.
I understand there's a motion to... to recommend the article as written. Is that...
Yep.
And it's been seconded.
And it was seconded, yes, true. Those in favor? Those opposed? Okay, so that was, all right.
I didn't take it.
I should have printed more copies of this. Okay.
You should go before it starts to rain. You could get out before it starts to rain.
Standing room only downstairs is, I believe it's a cribbage game or something like that. I saw all the cars and like, oh my God, people coming to a meeting.
Kidding first.
Thank you very much, sir. Okay, we will reconsider the officers for this committee the next time we convene. The next time we convene, I assume we will be faced with a warrant for a town meeting in September. Having said that, I would like to bring to everybody's attention the fact that two selectmen's meetings ago, I sat with the select board and recommended to them that when they schedule town meetings, they consult with this committee first. Okay, because one of the things that occurred several times last year was we were faced with being presented with a warrant and told when it had to be done, and for the annual town meeting, the time frame we were told when we first received it was 11 days. And that does not give this committee the time necessary to do what it is supposed to do according to the ordinance. So again, I have recommended at least to the selectmen that before they set a meeting, schedule a town meeting, that they consult with us with a copy of the warrant that we're looking at so we know what we have to do and can gauge the amount of time that we're going to need to proceed forward.
When they come out, when Ms. Rue comes out with a copy of a warrant, I had a very difficult time trying to print it out from my computer today. I don't know whether that's always the case. Is it always in a format that doesn't allow for printing?
No, there is an issue. I was able to print it.
Oh, you were?
I was as well.
Yeah.
You were as well?
Yeah.
Yes. Windows 7?
My poor computer just crossed the border. Okay. And it's having
that could
a hard
be
time.
The other thing you can do sometimes, I think that was a docs file. You could generate that in a PDF and probably print it then too. You can convert it to a PDF or export it to a PDF. Print it.
Tom, in kind of support of that, if maybe, Ed, if you wanted to kind of communicate this, if you wish, to your fellow board members, looking at the Warrant and Finance Committee ordinance, which was passed at town meeting and therefore is, you know, coming from the highest level of government we have in our town, 1C says, after due consideration and study of a proposed warrant article, the committee shall make a recommendation as to whether the proposed warrant article should be approved based on the committee's consideration of both the general advisability of the proposed warrant article and its financial impact. So a couple of points there. First off, it says that the committee shall make a recommendation, which I think is going to be interpreted, I know at least how I interpret it, is as must, which means that the warrant cannot go to be voted on until the recommendation has been made. And because the town meeting also directed the committee that they must take due consideration and study, if we could come with, to a respectful agreement as to how much time the Warrant and Finance Committee needs, with reason, I mean, there does need to be a balance to be had to keep the Warrant and Finance Committee from stewing for too long, okay? But I think that it would be good to set up some expectations early on in the budgeting season so that there isn't an additional level of potential contentiousness going forward.
This particular one tonight, we're on a time crunch with that, based on setting the tax rate for the town.
Understand, it was understood.
And the schools voting their money forward, you know, so that was...
We agreed about that 2 weeks ago.
And neither one of these issues were really contentious.
Right, yeah.
Sure. And that's fine. And we came to that agreement ahead of time with an understanding. We weren't, didn't have a warrant passed to us and told us we had to have it done by a certain time.
Okay,
that's fine. That's good. The other issue I would like to bring to the attention of this board moving forward has to do with the email from Jen of 7/31/2015, specifically the last paragraph instructing us that we are not to contact other officers, municipal officers of the town directly, but pass all requests through the Board of Selectmen. I need to remind the Board of Selectmen, I think, and we need to work on this together, that this board is elected by the town meeting and therefore is responsible to the town meeting as you are. We sit at an equal level of power, if you will, or I don't like using that term.
Of reporting responsibility.
Okay, and again, our responsibility is the people who hire us and tell us what we're supposed to do. So we need to think this thing through. I frankly do not like being told that I can't talk to that kid over there who I've known since he was this high, okay, or other people, all right? And I think that's from my perspective, I find that very frustrating, and I think the board will find it very frustrating moving through. Having said that, it has also occasioned errors because our town clerk has much too much to do. She has passed information along that was incorrect, causing people to miss meetings or be too early at meetings, etc. Okay? So...
Right.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Right. So these things happen. And that's fine. And I understand how those things can happen. But this board and the select board have always, to the best of my knowledge, in my history, as part of the town government, operated with great cordiality. And I see no reason why that cannot be the case moving forward. Needless to say, this past year was not cordial from my perspective. And I would hope that the future chairman of this board does not have to deal with that scenario again.
I just have a question to the selectman who's here. Is it the process of the selectman committee to rotate around all the committees, or will we have you as our representative of the selectmen throughout this year?
We do try to rotate them every year.
Okay.
You know, if someone wants to take up a different committee, we did swap some around this year.
But normally, once you're accustomed to coming to a meeting, we can expect you to be at the meetings and not somebody else.
Usually, unless we're busy with another meeting.
Understand.
I'm on fire. I'm on fire. I'm on their liaison in this. They have a meeting tonight. We have a meeting back here. One of the other selectmen is at that meeting.
Understand.
I guess I would, to that kind of continue on with what Tom was saying, the support for that argument is again in 1C, that we are tasked by the town meeting to do our own study and consideration of articles, and we cannot do that without being able to speak to the people that know about the article, and that to ask an autonomous board to receive permission from a separate autonomous board, especially for something like the school committee. The select board has absolutely zero authority with the school committee and has no right or reason to speak for us to this.
I might disagree with that a little bit, but that's okay.
We can do that privately.
Yes.
So,
and cordially.
And cordially, yes. We'll keep our sense of humor. I think it is something that we also, if it's going to be an issue, because you are one member of three, you can't, you know, speak for the board. My understanding of the process is that if we wish to push the issue, if the select board insists on having it go through legal, we can't even get a final reading until we as a board have requested that as a group.
I don't think we need to go that far yet, but.
I agree. I think it should be something to be thought of by the select board to find out if at our next meeting we are going to have to ask for that legal opinion.
Well, I think the way to go with that is to go to MMA. They would be the ones to answer that.
But we're not able to go to MMA without a full board of our committee, a full vote of our committee to ask to do so.
But that's a remedy that we don't necessarily have to seek.
Let's not go there.
I agree. My point was that when Ed is speaking to his fellow board members, if they are not in agreement that this is how the relationship should go, if he could report that back to us at our next meeting so that we can then take that vote to have the legal response.
Thank you. I understand that. Very good. Good point. Procedural. Okay. I have one other issue, Ed, that I'd like to discuss with you or bring to your attention. This also involves Peter, because I understand we do have somewhere along the line a draft of an ordinance, fire department. My problem with this is, and I'm going to be very frank about this, is this has been done, to the best of my knowledge, behind closed doors, okay? And I have a problem with that. You understand that I have a problem with that already. We know that, okay? That we can resolve. But this board will be very concerned with determining that, or I think it will be anyway, very concerned with determining that what comes forward is well supported and well understood by the current members of the fire and rescue, all right? That it has the endorsement and sort of support that was encouraged in the development of the report that you folks had, and that kind of backing is there. I'd love to know, for instance, that the fire department has had a discussion of this and they voted for it, and that the rescue has too. That's up to you guys, okay? We'll satisfy ourselves, make our recommendations. But I haven't looked at a draft, and I'm not going to look at a draft until I have a draft before me that I'm told it is, because I don't need to get excited about something that is, right, that might change. I don't need to go there, okay? But I'm telling you what my expectations are now, okay, or what my hopes are now. Anyway, you probably don't have any knowledge of this, but the town meeting has written ordinances and done a very good job at them. The road ordinance we have was a creation of the town meeting. It took 4 years to do it, okay, and it was not a very popular ordinance when it went through, but when it went to the town meeting, everybody understood it, and there was not a negative vote on the floor. Not that they were real happy with it, but it went through the process publicly and openly so that by the time it got to the floor of the town meeting, that consensus had been established, and everybody understood why it said what it did. And that process, from my perspective right now, is missing in this. So, just a heads up, okay? All right.
The ordinance that will be coming forward, coming before you shortly,
right,
is a collaboration between fire and rescue.
Okay.
And I sat on the board as well.
Yep. Okay, that's okay. We don't need to go there right now. I want to see what it looks like. Everybody here will want to see what it looks like.
See how the process
works. Right. Okay. Petey, you got something to say? Go ahead.
I'm just going to add with what he said. Once with the fire chief, the existing rescue chief, Richard Neal,
yep,
the select person.
Yep.
When we first added, which was on Warrant and Finance, we tried to add that check and balance with all the departments that we thought needed to be there. We in no means tried to hide anything.
I didn't say you did. I just, I didn't see it published anywhere. I don't see any tapes of it. Okay, so I don't know the discussion that went into it. Again, what I'm concerned about is, not here, but over there, that your people are in support of it. We do know several things. We do know that when we start hiring people, lots of volunteers disappear, okay? That has happened all around us. We want to know that every effort has been made to avoid that happening in this scenario. That's one of several issues that concern me. But we don't need to go there because we don't have anything in front of us to discuss right now, okay?
I really have to know the topic you just said about how volunteers who leave, that does happen. But also, unfortunately, we know as a trend coming forward, even if we didn't hire full-time people, volunteers will be not with them.
I understand that. Right.
And I talked to the AC on the way up here because he's talking a couple places different times.
Yep.
I made sure that he was reassuring our volunteers, we're not out to replace our volunteers.
Right.
Our volunteers are well needed, we appreciate our volunteers, and it shows, as the last one I just said.
Yep.
So, again, if they're leaving because of hiring full-time, I don't know what else to do, we'll reassure them, we'll make everything positive. It's going to be a tough transition. I've talked to a lot of fire chiefs who've gone this route over years and years, and they forewarn me on some of that transition. Unfortunately, that's what it is. But we're not out to give up our volunteers. We need our volunteers in the community. We're just trying to reassure that first emergency response, something is going out that door in minutes, not 20, 30, 40 minutes later. That's all we're trying to do.
I understand that.
Yeah, I understand it, but the only other thing that I would say is I think that in the long run, something should be in here that the town is going to make, whether it's through the committee or the department or the selectmen or whatever, a real concerted effort to start reaching out to communities at this end of the county to have shared services for some of this. Because we cannot continue that particular aspect of civic life by a 4,000 populated town doing everything that's going to need to be done in the future. And there are towns that are bigger than this, and Jacksonville, Florida is bigger than York County. They can work out a way, if we could try as a part of our policy, to start discussions with neighboring towns for shared services. I really, really think that's our only way out of this. 5 years from now, it's going to be absolutely untenable, no matter how many volunteers we have.
I agree with you 100%.
And I hope that's going to be in the plan and the ordinance that you all put together, is that it's understood that eventually we're going to have to seek out the assistance and the connections with other towns in a similar situation so that we can have a united front and make an efficient service that covers a large area and does so without breaking the back of the coffers of each town.
Couple of things. With the ordinance, we can't write for the future, we have to write for right now. So if it changes, I agree with James Warren, you just don't know. But from, I think, almost day one, since I became fire chief, I've been very clear on trying to consolidate with other towns and not necessarily jump into a countywide thing, but at least...
No, not a countywide thing. I think around the towns surrounding us, Newfield, all the rest of them at this end of the county, I think is...
But what I can say to that is, I'm the fire chief. I have a lot of power, but when it comes to that particular thing, I'm a peon. I have no clout at all for that. I get the word out, I try to do studies. Towns are very territorial.
Well, and I can understand that each town has been territorial, but we're at an instant now with this particular kind of a problem. We're at an instant now where we need to stop looking at it as a single town entity problem. That's my only point, and that we should have something in the ordinance or something in as an addendum that we're going to make every attempt to start an active program of trying to seek unity and cooperation amongst all the towns in this area for a common goal.
Well, I think your point is well taken, but frankly, I don't think that's the chief's job here.
I have not seen the ordinance. I'm just saying that an ordinance about this issue,
right,
and where we have a paucity of volunteers and we have a paucity of money, ought to include the fact that we're going to have an active program of trying to seek out cooperation with other towns.
I agree with you, it has to happen. We've been historically, Maine and New England states have been very territorial, and we've got to get over it sooner or later.
History's caught up with us.
But, well, it's going to catch up with our pocketbook.
I'm going to help.
Right, but this is really not the chief's job, this has to happen at the what's the group?
National level.
The nine town group, the 10 or 11.
I think it's 13 towns.
13 town group, right. Okay, Larissa?
Well, I was hoping that, I didn't see it, but under maybe other agenda items, could we discuss, so also in the ordinance that we've referenced a couple of times, we are required by ordinance to assign our own liaisons to the different other boards in town. Could we take care of that?
I would prefer not to do it tonight after we choose officers, okay, because we don't want to load too many people up. It's too many different directions.
And also, we don't have our good board members who are missing to elect.
I understand that. Okay.
Okay, so can we postpone that too?
We can.
I understand that.
Some of us just have really full falls coming up, and the sooner I could know what other group I needed to meet with, the easier my life would fall into line.
We'll make your life as easy as possible.
I don't need an easy life, I just need a scheduled life. I'd like to call dibs on the fire department.
Okay. The temporary chair will entertain a motion to adjourn, and then I have an announcement to make.
After the adjournment, Mr. Chairman?
Yes. I would think that's not part of the agenda of the particular meeting. And I think that goes to your issue, right?
Prior to adjournment, I'd just like to share something with the committee.
I'm sorry?
This is the draft of the zoning proposal, which is coming for a public hearing this Thursday at 7 p.m. Will probably be the second.
My announcement. Excuse me, go ahead.
Are you stealing your thunder there?
No. You're welcome to do the thunder. I'm sick and tired of doing thunder.
It's the second item hearing on the agenda. There's a small item preceding it. I would guess it would be safe to turn up by 7:15 and not miss anything on this. I wouldn't want to tell you to come any later. This is the draft that we have received from the select board to date, and the planning board has reviewed this and made some, we have not reviewed this particular article. We reviewed the first draft of this.
This is a public hearing?
Yes.
Well, okay. And that's this Thursday?
Yes, sir. And just so Ed knows, I made a call today and spoke to the chairman of the planning board's answering machine, asking him to please consider if it would be feasible to talk to the chairman of the select board. We could have Attorney Lankowski in residence at that public hearing, so someone could speak to the questions that might arise pertaining to the select board's warrant article. This is not of the devise of the planning board. We're hosting the hearing because it's our purview to do that. But I would urge strongly, Ed, if you could support that notion, it would hopefully certainly clarify some things that the board cannot clarify. We can't speak to the thinking of the board on this, nor to Joe's thinking. I called Bob Smith and asked him to please consider call in to Ted to see if we could get permission to have Joe help us facilitate that meeting. Otherwise, we're kind of talking about a subject that we don't quite understand.
I would like to close this meeting because I don't think this is part of our agenda for tonight because we don't even have a firm thing before us. So if it's okay with you, we'll continue the discussion after we vote to adjourn this meeting. Is that all right? Okay. Does anybody have a problem with that?
No.
Okay. So the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn the meeting.
I so move.
Okay. Seconded?
Second.
All in favor? Aye. Opposed?